keep my spirit stayed and sure when the midnight meets.
Good morning, and a very warm welcome to our worship this morning. We come in to the presence of the living Lord Jesus, and may the grace of the risen Lord Jesus be with each of us. A warm welcome to everybody, whether you're in the building or you're watching at home just now, live or later on in the week. And an especial welcome to friends from Lenzie Old for this one of our joint services in the summer, those who are in the building and those who are worshipping at home. We're joined together through faith and love for the living Lord Jesus Christ. Just a few notices. Sunday chat, the opportunity to catch up on Zoom, is on again this morning, or this afternoon, 12:30 until 1 p.m. If you need the login details, then just drop me an email and I'll send them to you. One of the things over the last months is that things keep changing, and although we've moved to level zero here on the 19th of July, it opens up the possibility of reducing social distancing and the possibility of singing under masks. Each congregation has to decide what to do, complete a risk assessment, and get approval from presbytery. And now that I'm back from holiday, we'll work through that this week and put a note in update next week, and we'll see where we get to this time next week. And keep you posted. Now, sadly, within Lenzie Union, we have four funerals of four of our members this week, some of which folk may already know about. Tomorrow, we have the funeral of John Mercer, and to Etta and to all who are missing John, our love and our prayers. And then on Tuesday in the morning, we have the funeral here in the church of Mrs. Margaret McConaughey, who's one of our most long-standing members in Lenzie Union and within the community of Lenzie, and to her sister Belle, and to all who are missing Margaret, our love and our prayers. And then on Tuesday afternoon, we have the funeral of Francis Birchall, who passed away last Tuesday, and our love and our prayers to Errol and Richard and Ian and Claire and all the family. The service for Francis will be live streamed at 2 o'clock from Daldowie. And if you'd like the link to watch that live or to watch it later, contact me or contact your elder who has the login details for that. And then on Saturday, the 31st of July, there's the funeral of Mrs. Nettie Lamb, and our love and our prayers to Sandra and Stephen and Janice and all the family. Now, the service for Nettie will also be live streamed from Daldowie. That's at 12 noon on Saturday. And the link to watch live or later isn't available yet, but if you'd like it, then please drop me an email, minister@lupc.org, or phone me or leave a message for me, and I'll send it to you when I get it. So let's pray. Loving God, you promise that you are the eternal God, and you are our refuge, and that underneath are the everlasting arms. Today we thank you for John and for Margaret, for Francis and for Nettie. We picture them within their families. We picture them in the places where we knew them or met them. We picture them sitting here in this place. As we thank you for them and all they mean to their families, all they mean within this community and this church family, we pray for their families. During the funeral services and in the days ahead, Enfold them, each of them, in your everlasting arms. And we pray this in the name of Jesus, our risen Saviour. Amen. As we draw near to God in the midst of our lives just now, to worship him, hear these words from Psalm 27 about seeking the Lord. One thing I ask of the Lord, this is what I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord and seek him in his temple. For in the day of trouble, he will keep me safe in his dwelling and set me high upon a rock. So we worship God, sitting and unfortunately not yet singing here in the building, but you can sing at home. Who has held the oceans in his hand? Based on Isaiah chapter 40. When we come to worship God together, to behold him and to adore him, we find that God is already here in his love, in our risen Lord Jesus Christ, inviting us to him just as we are just now. So we're going to hear some words of Jesus, which Christine Cook is going to read for us. We'll hear it in a variety of translations this morning, but first from the Authorized Version. Matthew chapter 11 and verses 25 to 30. Christine.
At that time, Jesus answered and said, I thank thee, O Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because thou hast hid these things from the wise and prudent, and hast revealed them unto babies. Even so, Father, for so it seems good in thy sight. All things are delivered unto me of my Father, and no man knoweth the Son but the Father. Neither knoweth any man the Father, save the Son, and he to whomsoever the Son will reveal them. Come unto me, all ye that labour and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you, and lean and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light.
So let's pray together. Loving Lord Jesus Christ, as a family of your people, you meet us here in the power of the Holy Spirit. You offer us your rest. We long for your rest and your peace. And you invite us to bring to you all that burdens us and makes us heavy laden. Into your everlasting arms, Lord, we place our lives, the decisions we're wrestling with, the things we're finding tough just now, the questions that we have. We place them into your hands. Loving Lord Jesus, you stand among us, the one who had nails driven into your hands on the cross, because you love us, because you gave your life so that we may be forgiven. Lord, we recognize that some of the reasons that we don't feel at peace with ourselves is because of the way we've been living, or speaking and acting, things that we've said and done which make us restless about ourselves and restless about our relationship with you. And yet you long for us to be at peace. You offer us your forgiveness when we ask through your death and resurrection. So, loving Father, in the quiet of these moments, we confess to you our mistakes, the things about us in the past days or the past years that haunt us. Lord, we are truly sorry. Have mercy upon us. Forgive us and cleanse us, we pray, in the name of Jesus. And fill us now, through the Holy Spirit, with your rest and your peace, so that we may serve you and love you and those around us. And these prayers we offer in Jesus' name, who taught us when we pray to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now, Kim, our youth worker at Lenzie Union, is going to share with us an all-age talk. Kim, good morning.
Hi, everyone. Today, we're going to think about seeking God. It made me think of the game of hide and seek. Have you played it, where you go and you seek out and you find the person who's hiding? Let's play a virtual version of this instead of a person hiding. I've hidden these rocks in some photos, and I want to see if you can seek out and find these rocks. Let's give it a go. Today's New Testament reading is from Matthew 11, 25 to 29. Come to me, all who labour and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your soul. Jesus talks a lot about seeking God and what it means, and the verses we just heard tell us that Jesus says that we should come to God. Jesus tells us that we should seek God in all that we do. And when it comes to God, he wants us to find him. We can find God's presence everywhere we go. When we go back through the doors of Lenzie Union or Lenzie Old, when we log on to our devices and watch the church service, when our burdens are heavy in our lives and it feels like we're carrying these weights around all the time, God is there. When life is going okay, or when we're anxious about the easing of restrictions, God will be there. On the beautiful hot summer days and the wet and windy days, we can see God's presence in the world around us. I could keep going, but I'd be here all day. How we do church has looked different for the majority of last year. Church has been online, or we've listened to it on CDs. And as we move into hybrid of in-person and online, our experience of church may change. But God doesn't. He's always there, and he wants us to seek and find him. God doesn't leave us, and he's always there. And the most important thing is that we seek God. God's there just waiting for us to seek him out and build a relationship with him through prayer, reading the Bible, sharing and hearing each other's stories. And that's not always on a Sunday either. It might be in youth group, coffee and chat with a friend, a phone call or a walk. We can find God in all places. We just need to look out for God, because he's always there. And as we seek God, his plans will be revealed for our lives and the lives of his church and what it might look like in the future. This week, why not take a moment to stop and see where you see God in your lives? Let's pray. God, thank you that you are always there for us, and help us to seek you more in our own lives. Amen.
Thank you, Kim. Seeking God. The God who seeks us in Jesus and says, come unto me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. We're going to think about these verses, these words of Jesus, a bit this morning. And we're going to hear it one last time in a different version again from the Message translation. Just the last two verses from the Message version, Matthew chapter 11, verses 28 to 30, which Christine is going to read for us.
Are you tired, worn out, burned out on religion? Come to me, get away with me, and you'll recover your life. I'll show you how to take a real rest. Walk with me and work with me. Watch how I do it. Learn the unforced rhythms of grace. I won't lay anything heavy or ill-fitting on you. Keep company with me, and you'll learn to live freely and lightly.
Thank you, Christy. We're probably very familiar with these words of Jesus probably love these words very much. Come unto me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, take my yoke upon you and learn of me. But there's something in that Message translation, I think, that really helps to unpack what this means. Learn the Put your glasses on first, Dan. Learn the unforced rhythms of grace. Learn the unforced rhythms of grace. I think that's a beautiful way of capturing what Jesus is talking about. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me. The unforced rhythms of grace. His yoke is not ill-fitting. His way is tailored individually as we follow him together. So we've got three images we'll look at this morning, and here's the first of them, and it's a picture of a door. We went round Brodick Castle Gardens a few weeks ago, and I find the pictures of these kind of doors really interesting, about going into different parts of the garden and seeing what you can find there. And an open door is a sign of invitation, just as Jesus says to us, come unto me and learn the unforced rhythms of grace. So we're on one side of the door just now, life as it is for us, for those around us at the moment. And Jesus is saying to us, come and learn the unforced rhythms of grace. What does that mean? Well, I think there are three basic things about that, which just coming into the building of the church or watching it at home can teach us. Rhythms of grace. First one is just the day that it is today, Sunday, Sabbath. An unforced rhythm of God's grace. Creation and rest. Activity and rest. Creation and worship and praise. Built in right from the very beginning of existence. An unforced rhythm of grace. Not as a rod to beat our back with, but for our good. The Sabbath rhythm. Creation and rest. Then this church, like most other churches, has a font for baptism, and that speaks to us of an unforced rhythm of grace. God's grace, we say, seeking us whether a child or adult before we're aware of it, before each baptism. The unforced rhythm of grace of God coming to us, bringing us into his family. His acceptance of us, the unforced rhythm of God's grace. We love because God loved us first. And then the third thing, here in this church and in most other churches, a communion table, unforced rhythm of grace, a place at the table, a place with God, a place in a community, a family of God's people. Unforced rhythm of grace, not on our own, but together. But the unforced rhythm of grace of we come to be fed by God and we go out to serve God and we come back to be fed by God and go out to serve God. Something a little bit about the unforced rhythm of grace in Sabbath, creation and rest. In baptism, acceptance in God's family. In communion, coming to be fed, going out to serve. So let's think about that just now, what that might mean in our own lives. As we think of ourselves as being at one side of the door, and Jesus saying to us now, why not come and learn the unforced rhythms of my grace in your life just now? We've got another picture. And this is a place where I've spent the last 3 weeks. This is Loch Ranza in Arran with the tide out. Sometimes people say, what did you do in your holidays? Well, I did a bit of gardening, a bit of cycling, a bit of this and that. But a lot I found of watching the tide. I find it fascinating to watch the tide. That's an unforced rhythm of grace. It comes in and it comes out. The tide comes in, and the seagulls and the oyster catchers, the seagulls float in the water and the oyster catchers fly about. The seals bob their heads up above the water, and the boats come in and anchor, or the boats go out into the Kilbrannan Sound. The tide comes in, and then the tide goes out. And the seaweed looks flat, and the oyster catchers aren't flying, they're pecking away at the seaweed. The herons are looking for fish. The seals are basking on the rocks, and some of the boats are stuck in the sand. And then 6 hours later, it's all change, and the tide's back in again. Watching the unforced rhythm of the tide. Now, when Jesus says to us, come and worship, come and meet with me, he invites us just to come and observe the unforced rhythms of his grace. From the beginning to now, to all time. Sabbath, creation, and rest. What are we needing? A chivvy up to get going? Or time to be still with the Lord? Of baptism, are we needing the assurance of his unforced rhythm of grace that in Christ we are part of his family? Is that what we need to know to go out of these doors knowing that we are God's precious child? Because that's what he wants us to learn. Or is it the rhythm of being fed or going to serve? Are we feeling we need a new challenge? Or are we feeling exhausted and need the Lord to feed us? Jesus says, just come to me and learn and accept my grace. Now, that picture of sunshine on Arran, it's all very placid and tranquil, but God's grace is deep. We're going to sing at home, the words of a hymn, Oh, the Deep, Deep Love of Jesus, that talks about the unforced rhythm of God's grace, written by a man called Samuel Francis. And one night he was walking through London as a young man, and he was walking over a bridge, Hungerford Bridge, and the water looked dark and choppy, and his mood turned very black and had very dark thoughts. And the question went round his mind is the grace of Jesus, is the love of Jesus enough for me in my life just now? And he reckoned that it was more than enough for now, forever. And he spent most of his life as a preacher. And he wrote this hymn based on that experience, Oh, the Deep, Deep Love of Jesus. And the tune which reflects this unforced rhythm of God's grace is called Ebenezer, which we thought of before the summer at Lenzie Union. The stone put up, thus far has the Lord blessed us. So, Oh, the Deep, Deep Love of Jesus.
Oh,
rhythm of God's grace, unforced, in Jesus Christ. Folks at Lenzie Union might associate that with communion. Ian Knox often played that tune as the bread and wine was passed around us and we received the symbols of the love of Jesus. The unforced rhythms of God's grace. We're going to root this, just briefly, in a reading from the Old Testament. And each of the next 3 weeks, we'll have readings from the Old Testament around this theme, which is the return of the Ark to Jerusalem in 1 Chronicles, the end of a traumatic time and trying to build back better. It seems in some ways appropriate to life at the moment. So Christine's going to read for us 1 Chronicles chapter 13 and verses 1 to 14.
David conferred with each of his officers, the commanders of thousands and the commanders of hundreds. He then said to the whole assembly of Israel, "If it seems good to you, and if it is the will of the Lord our God, let us send word far and wide to the rest of our people throughout the territories of Israel, and also to the priests and Levites who are with them in their towns and pasture lands, to come and join us. Let us bring the Ark of our God back to us, for we did not require it during the reign of Saul." The whole assembly agreed to this because it seemed right to all the people. So David assembled all Israel from the river Shihor in Egypt to Lebo Hamath to bring the Ark of God from Kiriath Jearim. David and all Israel went to Balaam of Judah, that is Kiriath Jearim, to bring up from there the Ark of God the Lord, who is enthroned between the cherubim, the Ark that is called by the name. They moved the Ark of God from Abinadab's house on a new cart, with Uzzah and Ahio guiding it. David and all the Israelites were celebrating with all their might before God, with songs and with harps, lyres, tambourines, cymbals, and trumpets. When they came to the threshing floor of Kidron, Uzzah reached out his hand to steady the ark because the oxen stumbled. The Lord's anger burned against Uzzah, and he struck him down because he had put his hand on the ark. So he died there before God. Then David was angry because the Lord's wrath had broken out against Uzzah, and to this day that place is called Perez Uzzah. David was afraid of God that day and asked, "How can I ever bring the ark of God to me?" He did not take the ark to be with him in the city of David. Instead, he took it to the house of Obed-Edom, the Gittite. The ark of God remained with the family of Obed-Edom in his house for 3 months, and the Lord blessed his household and everything he had. Amen.
Well, explore the different things about the return of the Ark to Jerusalem over the next couple of weeks, but today just something very brief. We've been thinking about the unforced rhythm of grace, but here's some people trying to force God's hand, and it talks to us just of the danger of that. Sometimes you try to get to the meaning of a passage of the Bible, then go to the most difficult part of the reading. And I don't know about you, but I find by far the most difficult part of this reading is what happened to Uzzah, this man, and he's just trying to steady the ark, and for steadying the ark and reaching out his hand, like, he's put to death by God, and David's angry and David can't understand it. It's really, really puzzling as to what this is about. I think the first thing to say is that in the light of Jesus, who says, come unto me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, I'll give you rest. That sort of thing is all past and in the past. That's not the way God deals with people in Jesus. But this story from centuries before can help us understand, because it's about somebody trying to force God's hand and force the rhythms of God's grace. Well, why do I say that? I think we need to think about what the Ark is about and what's going on here. The Ark of the Covenant, it's a box, I think probably about the size of this communion table. It's about four and a half feet long and 2.5 feet high and 2.5 feet deep. And there's a picture of it by an artist called John Tiso, who did it in 1900, on the screen there. And what the Ark of the Covenant was for, it was built out of acacia wood and then covered in gold just at Mount Sinai, where the Ten Commandments were given. And inside the Ark, well, there was the tablets of stone, the Ten Commandments, and there was Aaron's staff, Moses' brother's staff, and there were some other things as well. And the Israelites carried it about from place to place. But actually, the real thing about the Ark of the Covenant is it symbolized God's presence. It wasn't that God was locked up in the box, but it symbolized God being with his people and traveling with his people. And it talks about the mercy seat, the bit just above the cherubim there, where they believed that God, well, they could come and ask God's guidance. It said that this happened after a time of trauma, and this was the really erratic and unhappy reign of Saul and David's conflicts with Saul, and there was just barbarity and killing, and David was trying to bring people together and bring people back to God. And we're told at the beginning of the reading they didn't inquire of God, they didn't ask God, they didn't pay any attention to the Ark. And in fact, the Ark had been captured by the Philistines. If you remember the bit in with a Samuel as a boy called in the temple, in the shrine at Shiloh, and here I am, Lord, and he's to go and tell Eli, the old priest, look, you've been found out, you and your boys, you're just absolutely corrupt. The Philistines came and destroyed the shrine at Shiloh, took the Ark away, found that the Ark was too holy for them, and it stayed in a place called Kiriath Yeraim with a family. The head of the family was Abinadab, and he had two descendants, Uzzah and Ahiho. Now, forced, unforced rhythms of God's grace. You'll notice in that picture that there are two poles along the box, along the Ark of the Covenant. And that's really important, because when the Ark was built, God said, look, when you're carrying the Ark, just carry it on the poles. And carry it and let people hold it on their shoulders. So it just rests there. And it looks, I guess, very natural. What David did was to force the issue. He was in a hurry to sort things out. And he built a new cart for it. And the thing should never have been in a cart. It should have been carried on the poles. David forced the issue, rushed things along. And Uzzah probably should have pointed this out as well and said, look, David, I've been with this ark for 20 years. It's been in our house. Now, you carry it with the poles, not the cart. It's puzzling what happened to Uzzah. But that's what's behind it. Somebody trying to force, hurry along God's rhythms. So if we go back to the picture of the door, as we're waiting for the door, let's just think about it. Us hearing the invitation of Jesus, come to me and learn the unforced rhythms of my grace. What does that mean for us as churches? at this stage in our lives, this stage of the pandemic. Don't try to rush things. Don't go ahead of God. Learn the unforced rhythms of my grace. In his book, Rewilding the Church, Steve Aisthorpe, who works at the Church of Scotland, talks about, well, churches can get very, very busy doing things, but how about if we just take Jesus at his word and focus on him, the most precious thing we have in the church, and learn the rhythms of his grace rather than being frenetically busy? We look at that beautiful picture of part of God's creation, and it makes us think of the rhythms of God's creation and how those are being spoiled. I was reading in the paper, really a heartfelt plea from a Roman Catholic bishop in Kenya, who talks about the natural rhythms of life in Kenya, which had been there was sun and the rains came, and the crops depended on that, and the animals depended on that, and they would sell the animals and the folk would get money. But because of global warming and the greed of people, these rhythms of creation have been upset, and the rains don't come. Crops don't grow, the animals don't grow. And his heartfelt plea is to 90 days before leaders meet for the COP26 summit in Glasgow is, think of these people, my people in Kenya, who are suffering because of people's greed, that the rains don't come and the rhythms of creation have been disturbed. And lastly, think about ourselves at that door. Come to me, says Jesus, at the start of this week, and learn of me. In the pattern of creation and rest, find your rest in me, your acceptance as my child. Come and be fed by me before you go and serve. So let's pray together. Lord, we give you thanks for the good things of creation, for the rhythm of the seasons, and we thank you for summer, for the warmth of the sunshine, for the kindness that other people bring to our lives. If we've been able to, Lord, we thank you for the privilege of being able to see family we haven't seen for a while. We thank you for laughter shared. We thank you for the relationships that are precious to us. And we ask for your blessing on those who shared something of their lives with us, particularly those who are finding it hard to sleep because they're always worried, or find they're so anxious that they don't want to eat, and the natural rhythms of living are difficult to sustain. Lord, we pray that you'll give them your rest and your peace, fill them with your love, and show us how to love and to help. Lord, we pray for your world and thank you for your good creation. We pray for areas of the world where the rhythms of creation have been particularly disturbed, and places like in Kenya where rains don't come as they used to, and lives and livelihoods are affected and destroyed. Lord, we pray that at the COP26 summit in Glasgow in November, leaders of the world will change things for the better. Lord, we pray for your church. Thank you that you trust us You trust us to share the unforced rhythms of Jesus' grace with people in Lenzie and the communities where we live and with our friends and our families. So we look to you and ask that you'll fill us with the love and peace of Jesus. Help us never to get caught up in things that don't matter. Bless your church here and throughout the world. We pray for our country. We thank you for the beauty of the countryside just now. And we pray for our leaders, for the Queen and our family. Prime Minister, First Minister, and those who are continually having to make decisions on our behalf. Lord, give them wisdom for that your kingdom will come. And Lord, we pray for the people whose needs are on our hearts and minds just now. For whatever reason, whatever stage of life they're at. And in the quiet, we name them before you and pray for them. We pray for ourselves. Lord, you say to us, come unto me and learn the unforced rhythms of your grace. Thank you for the things you're teaching us. And help us now to go out into the week ahead in your strength. Alone with none but thee, my God, I journey on my way. What need I fear when thou art near, O King of night and day? More safe am I within thy hand than if a host should round me stand. These prayers we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. So we go to live out the unforced rhythms of the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ in our own life and among those around us. And our last hymn, I, the Lord of Sea and Sky.
Thank you.
Go in peace, and may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, rest and remain upon you, today and always. Amen.